MedCram.
Hi, welcome to another MedCram lecture. We're going to talk about the jugular venous pulse. Specifically, we're going to talk about how to measure it, what it's good for, and what the diagnostic considerations are in terms of interpreting the waveforms. So if you take a look at the heart, you've got the left side and the right side. This is primarily something we're going to look at here on the right side, where we put in a central line into the internal jugular vein and down into the SVC, which is usually where the tip is. Now, this is a hollow tube, and so we're actually able to actually measure in a central line what's going on in this vessel, which is a extension of the right atrium. Now, you can also do this, and we'll talk about this later, you can also do something called a right heart catheter, where we actually float a right heart cath in here into the right atrium, into the right ventricle, into the pulmonary artery, and we wedge the catheter here, which, as you recall, after it goes to the lungs, will come back and actually measure what's going on in the left atrium. So yes, we are able to actually measure what's going on in the left atrium. But for right now, let's just talk about the jugular venous pulse, which is a measurement that we get in the internal jugular vein, the tip of which is in the SVC. So again, to review, there's two ways that you can look at a JVP. You can either look at the output from a central line that you've placed, or number two, you can just look at the patient's JVP, jugular venous pulse, and that's the internal jugular vein. So that's when they're lying down, you can actually look at that area that's just around the sternocleidomastoid, or the SCM, and look at the waveform as it comes up. The rest of today's discussion is going to be on specifically the central line wave output, because that's one way we can actually look at the waveform and see what the waveform is doing and actually measure the waveform. So we'll talk about that. Before we get to that, I wanted to sort of clarify a little bit, though, when we should measure the central venous pressure in a central line, and that is when someone is breathing spontaneously versus when someone is breathing on the ventilator. So this is supposed to signify what the intrathoracic pressure is. And the intrathoracic pressure also affects the central venous pressure because the veins are running in the thorax. So when someone is breathing spontaneously, this is their intrathoracic pressure before they take a breath in. And then when they take a breath in, the intrathoracic pressure goes down. And then when they breathe out, it comes back up again. Well, this is exactly what's going to happen to the central venous pressure. And so when you're looking at the waveforms, it's going to be changing. And so depending on what point during the respiratory cycle you're at, you're going to get a different waveform. And so the key point here is to always measure at the end of exhalation. This is the true point of measurements. The same thing goes for when you're breathing on a ventilator, except, however, when you're breathing on a ventilator, instead of breathing in and having a negative pressure in your chest, the ventilator is pushing air into your chest. And as a result of that, the intrathoracic pressure doesn't go down, but instead it goes up. The same principle applies. You should always check the central venous pressure at the end of exhalation. As a result of that, you'll see here indifferently that when you're measuring it on someone who's breathing spontaneously without positive pressure ventilation, that measurement's always going to be at the top of the cycle on an exhalation. When someone is breathing on a ventilator, it's always going to be at the bottom, but still end exhalation. So I just want to make that point for those of you who actually measure central venous pressure. I think I want to now switch to actually talking about the actual waveforms that we see on the jugular venous waveform. And the point that I want to bring up here again is specifically where actually we're measuring. Remember, the central line is going into the internal jugular vein and it's resting just at the tip of the SVC and where the right atrium is, anywhere along this line. And so think about the things that are going to make the pressure here go up and think about the things that are going to make the pressure go down. Okay, so let's think about things that would make the pressure go down, and that'll make sense later. So things that are going to make the pressure go down is going to be if we have the atria, the right atrium, if it's relaxing, if the volume is getting bigger. So atrial relaxation is going to make the pressure go down. Okay? What else could make the pressure go down? Well, if the tricuspid valve opens and blood is allowed to leave the right atrium and go into the right ventricle. So tricuspid valve open. All right, what would make the pressure go up in this area? Well, we know that the right atrium can contract, and so when it does contract, it's going to squish that blood into a smaller space. That's going to make the pressure go up. So atrial contraction is going to make it definitely go up. And also the closure of this valve. So if the opening of the valve makes it go down, the closure of this valve, so tricuspid closure, what's going to happen when this valve closes? Remember that blood is always coming towards the heart. And so as a result of that, if everything is in a closed system, the pressure is always going to start to rise if this valve is closed, because this chamber is continuously filling up with blood. So with that kind of knowledge, let's actually go over what the waveform looks like. So here's a sample of what the waveform looks like. At first it looks kind of complicated, but it actually is not. And we've got certain waves here, and you'll see that over and over again. The first wave I want to bring your attention to is the A wave. Okay, that's that first bump. The second is the C wave. Okay, and then we have an X descent. And then we have a V wave. And then finally, we have the Y descent. And it starts all over again. And so this area right here corresponds to this area right here. And so this is one cycle. Now, based on what we said before, remember where we're measuring this. We're measuring this in the superior vena cava. So what is this A wave here? This A wave is simply atrial contraction. And as such, you're going to see that when the atria contract, you're going to be going through, starting from about right here, atrial systole. This is where the right atrium is actually contracting to about this point right here. And then you've got atrial diastole. Okay? So when the actual muscle of the atria contract, you're going to get this upswing in pressure. At that point, and it's right about here, you'll get closure of the tricuspid valve. This is because systole occurs, ventricular systole occurs. Okay, we'll put that up here. Ventricular systole. As a result of that, when the right ventricle contracts, it's going to close the tricuspid valve. Now, there are some people that believe that this bump right here is the tricuspid valve actually closing and coming up into the right atrium, causing a little bit of a bump. Some people also believe that this C stands for carotid artery, because the carotid artery runs right next to the jugular venous pulse, and that pulsation is also going to cause an increase in the pressure that is sensed in the internal jugular vein. Whichever way you like to think about it, this C here is the beginning of ventricular contraction. Now that the valve is closed, however, what occurs is the atria continues to relax. As it started here, it continues to relax down, because remember, we're measuring pressure on the right side. And so X specifically is atrial relaxation. And that's important to remember. Now that the atria has relaxed and the X wave has, as we see here, the X wave is causing a descent, which means that the pressure is going down in the right atrium. There's going to come a point where the blood is continuing to come in to that right atrium, and it's going to start to fill up again until it reaches a certain point here, right about the top here, where the tricuspid valve opens. And as a result of that, the blood then leaves the right atrium and goes into the right ventricle, and you have the Y descent. So what is the Y descent? Is blood from the atria going down into the ventricle. So what is V? V is specifically filling of the right atrium. I like to say V stands for Willing. Okay, imagine a German saying filling. Willing, there is filling of the right atrium. So again, to review, A is atrial contraction. Then you have the C wave, which is caused by right ventricular contraction. After that, you have relaxation of the right atrium, which causes the X descent. Then the tricuspid valve finally opens at the top of the V wave. So you have relaxation and then filling. When the valve opens, again, the pressure drops again, and you have the right ventricle is now filling during the Y wave. And then finally, you get back up to the top again, and you're back at another A wave. So to review again, A is atrial contraction, C is ventricular contraction, X descent is atrial relaxation, V is atrial filling passively, and then finally, Y descent is blood going from the atria down to the ventricle on the way back up to another atrial contraction. Thank you for joining us. Look for the second in the series where we talk about the pathology and how this waveform can actually help us make diagnoses.